Red Brick Media. High quality CDs, DVDs, lectures, khutbah, conferences and Quran recitations. All revenue generated supports our dawah work, supported by visiting our store. You can now purchase directly from our site, www.redbrickmedia.co.uk.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيد خلق الله أجمعين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن سار على سبيله ونهجه واستنى بسنته واهتدى بهديه إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليما كثيرا، أما بعد. So last week we finished, we were discussing the chapter of Mawaqit, the timings for the prayer, and we finished with the general rules of timings in terms of when the times of Salah begins and when it ends. And then we were discussing some of the exceptions or some of the clarifications and details to those rulings. So we stopped at hadith number 138. وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الفجر فجران، فجر يحرم الطعام وتحل فيه الصلاة، وفجر تحرم فيه الصلاة أي صلاة الصبح ويحل فيه الطعام. رواه ابن خزيمة والحاكم وصححه، وللحاكم من حديث جابر نحوه، وزاد في الذي يحرم الطعام إنه يذهب مستطيلا في الأفق، وفي الآخر إنه كذنب السرحان. On the authority of Abdullah ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما, who said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said Fajr is of two types: a Fajr in which eating is haram and it is allowed to pray, and a fajr in which it is haram for you to pray, meaning the fajr prayer, but it is allowed for you to eat. And this is collected by Ibn Khuzaymah and Imam al-Hakim, and they both authenticated it. And in another narration of Imam al-Hakim on the authority of Jabir radiallahu anhu, he said concerning the fajr in which it is not allowed to eat, indeed it is like a straight line that goes in the horizon. And in another narration, it is like the tail of a wolf or a fox. This hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, firstly, it is this narration that is brought of Abdullah ibn Abbas, which is collected in Ibn Khuzaymah and Imam al-Hakim. It is a statement of Ibn Abbas, and it is not authentic as a hadith. So what is authentic is that it is a statement of Ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma. However, there are other supporting narrations that are mentioned from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the hadith is authentic, even though this particular narration is the statement of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma. This hadith speaks about the timing for Fajr, and that is that there are two Fajr timings. There are two times for Fajr, or two Fajrs, two dawns that are known. The first is known as Fajrul Kadhib, the false dawn. And the second one is known as Al-Fajr Al-Sadiq, the true dawn. And that's because when you look at the horizon at that time, and again in the UK it's not always very clear, but if you were to go to the Middle East and some of these other countries, you would see that before Fajr comes in, there is a time before Fajr where there is some lightness in the sky. It looks like something is rising in the sky. There is some lightness that you see in the sky, and this is known as Fajr al-Kadhib, the false dawn. That lighting, that light that comes in the horizon, will disappear, and then it will go back to darkness again. And then after this, you will have the true Fajr, the true dawn, and that is when the sun is beginning to rise. And that's when you see a true dawn. So the Prophet ﷺ was mentioning both of these types of Fajrs. The first one is the Fajr in which it is haram to eat and it is allowed to pray. And that is the true Fajr, the true dawn. Because as soon as dawn comes in, and obviously we're talking about in Ramadan when you're fasting, this hadith is in that context. When that Fajr comes in, it is allowed for you to pray, meaning the time of prayer has entered, and it is now haram for you to eat. So as soon as Fajr begins, it is time for you to stop eating. And that's why the time of fasting, as we mentioned in the chapter of fasting, is from the time of Fajr. As soon as Fajr enters, and the adhan is given for Fajr, as soon as the time begins for Fajr, and normally the adhan would be given, as we said, at the beginning of that time, then that is the time when it is not allowed for you to eat, but it is allowed for you now to pray. The Fajr which comes before that, which is the false dawn, and Fajr al-Kadhib, is where it is allowed for you to continue eating, haram for you to pray. Because the true time of Fajr has not yet entered. It has not yet entered, And so it is not allowed for you to pray. Fajr is not entered yet, it's not time to pray. And it's allowed for you to eat because the time of Fajr has also not entered. In the time of the Prophet ﷺ, what they would do was that they would have two adhans. They had two adhans. One was before Fajr by some time, and that was to show people that it's time to celebrate the Hajj, the relevant hadith. And it's the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, eat and drink. When Bilal makes the adhan, continue to eat and drink, and do so until you hear the adhan of Ibn Ummi Maktum. So we know that the Prophet ﷺ had a number of muadhins. One of them was Bilal radiallahu an, who was obviously the famous illustrious companion. He was one of the muadhins of the Prophet ﷺ, and shortly we're going to come on to the chapter of adhan and we'll speak more about him. One of the other muadhins of the Prophet ﷺ in Medina was a man by the name of Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktum, and he was a blind man, one of the companions from Mecca, one of the muhajirin who was blind, and one of the early to these people. And so Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned this in the Quran, and he said that someone like Ibn Ummi Maktum, even though he was poor and he was blind and so on, he has more right to you than these noblemen. Because these noblemen of Quraysh don't want to accept Islam, they don't want to worship Allah, they just want to have a privileged status. Whereas this man, he's sincere, he's come to you to learn about his religion and to come closer to Allah. So he was, the point here being, he was one of the muadhins. So the Prophet ﷺ would say to the companions, when you hear Bilal make the adhan, continue to eat and drink. Meaning it's not time for Fajr yet. That's the first adhan. And continue to do so until you hear the adhan of Ibn Ummi Maktum radiallahu anhu. So this issue of the two fajrs and the two adhans for fajr is something established in the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. The only other prayer where we have this ritual of having two adhans is for the Jum'ah prayer. And that was something which was established during the time of Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, when the Muslims became more prosperous during his time and during his khilafah, and the city of Medina had expanded somewhat. They found that the Muslims were late coming to Jum'ah. Because as you know, the adhan of Jum'ah is given when the imam stands on the minbar. Stands on the minbar, gives salams, then the adhan is given. So if someone's busy in their world, in their job, doing whatever they're doing, and they hear the adhan, by the time they get ready, come back from work, take a shower, get ready, come to the masjid, they'll have missed a lot of the khutbah, if not all of the khutbah. And so what Uthman radiallahu anhu did was that he installed another adhan, one that came before, so that when the companions heard that first adhan, they knew that the time of Jum'ah was approaching. They would leave off their work, their jobs and so on, and prepare for Jum'ah, and then come to the masjid. And this is something which is also still done in the two Haramain, in Mecca and Medina. They still have two adhans for Jum'ah, even though the gap between the two is actually very minimum, right? It's like a 5-10 minute gap. But the sunnah is to actually, or not the sunnah, but the practice of one of the khulafa was to make a longer gap between the two. So this is the hadith of the two fajrs. One of the other narrations that is mentioned here by Ibn Hajr rahimahullah in the same narration is speaking again about the fajr which is not correct. And that is that it comes as if it is a line in the horizon. So when you see that line in the horizon, that line will then disappear, and that is the fajr which is incorrect, and Allah Azza wa Jal knows best. The next hadith, hadith number 139, وعن ابن مسعود رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أفضل الأعمال الصلاة في أول وقتها رواه الترمذي والحاكم وصححه وأصله في الصحيحين. On the authority of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu an, who said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the best of actions is to pray the prayer at its earliest time, collected by Imam al-Tirmidhi and Imam al-Hakim, and authenticated by both of them, and it is also in al-Bukhari and Muslim. This hadith with this wording and this narration is in al-Tirmidhi, and it is authentic. But the other narration that is being referred to by Ibn Hajr rahimahullah is what is found in al-Bukhari and Muslim, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was asked about the best of actions, and he said, it is iman billah, to have faith in Allah. Then he was asked, what next? He said, to pray the prayer at its earliest time. Then he was asked, what's next? And then he said, jihad fi sabidillah, to make jihad in the path of Allah. In another hadith, he said, birrul walidain, to be righteous and good to your parents. So this hadith is being brought here really by Ibn Hajar rahimahullah ta'ala just to emphasize a point that we made last week. And that is that the general rule of thumb for all of the prayers, with the exception of Isha, is that you pray it at its earliest time. So as soon as the time comes in to pray it at its earliest time, that is the sunnah. With the exception of Isha, we said to delay it as much as possible before its time finishes. That is the sunnah with regards to Isha. So this is really just re-emphasizing that point. One of the benefits that we take from this hadith though, is that the Prophet ﷺ would often be asked this question. And when you go through the sunnah, you have this question being asked many times. What is the best action? What is the best action? What is the best thing that we can do? And what you find is that in most of these ahadith, the Prophet ﷺ gave a different answer. So for some people he said, it is to pray. For some people he said, it is iman billah. For some people he said, it is birrul walidain, be good to your parents. For some people he said, it is jihad. Then there are other similar ahadith in which the Prophet ﷺ would say, the best of you are those who are best to their families. And then he would say, for example, the best of you are those who learn the Qur'an and teach the Qur'an. So the scholars said, why are there so many different ahadith with basically the same issue? The same question or the same context is being given, but there is always a different answer. And what the scholars said is that the Prophet ﷺ would address people depending on their needs. So for example, maybe this person came to the Prophet ﷺ and he said, O Messenger of Allah, what is the best deed, meaning that I can perform? And so the Prophet ﷺ would know that this person maybe was weak in his prayer, or that he wasn't very conscious about his prayer. And so he said to him, pray at its earliest time. Maybe another person had weak iman. So he said, the best action for you is iman billah. Maybe someone else had elderly parents. So he said for them that it is that you are good to your parents. Someone else is teaching the Quran and learning the Quran and so on. So this shows that the Prophet ﷺ, from his fiqh, from his understanding, and this is from one of the benefits that we have even in advising one another, that you understand the situation of the person coming to you. So if someone asks you a question or they seek your advice, one of the things that you need to know is the situation of that person. Someone says to you, what is the best act I can do? Obviously the best act that you can do is either going to be the prayer, or it is zakah, or it is hajj. But if you know the particular situation of that person, then you know how to direct them. Maybe that person has no issues in prayer, no issues in zakah, no issues in fasting, but they don't make hajj, even though they have the ability to do so. So for them it is to make hajj. Maybe for someone else it is prayer. Maybe for someone else it is something else. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ said to Hafsa radiallahu anha, his wife, when she asked concerning her brother Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, he said, Abdullah ni'mar rajul, he is a great blessed man, if only he would pray during the night, meaning tahajjud, qiyamul layl. And so the Prophet ﷺ knew much about Abdullah ibn Umar, but he knew that he was weak in this area. So he said, he's a great man, a blessed man, a righteous man, if only he prayed during the night. And that was something specific for him. And so Abdullah ibn Umar said, when I heard that, I have never ever left the night prayer since. Every single day, I pray the night prayer. So the Prophet ﷺ would give his answers pertaining to each individual. And that is also from fiqh al-fatwa, from the understanding that the scholar or the student of knowledge or someone should have when answering a question, that you take in the situation of the people. And Shaykh Ibn Al-Thaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, he has a very good example of this that he mentions in one of his lectures, and that is that someone asked him, my wife, is she mahram to my uncle? So my uncle, can he be the mahram of my wife? Can my uncle be the mahram of my wife? And so the Shaykh replied, and he said, it depends what you mean by uncle. Right? So normally someone would have just given an answer straight away, yes or no. Yes, your uncle is mahram, no he's not. But the Shaykh knew and he understood that uncle has so many different meanings. Right? Uncle is a generic term. Like in the masjid you see an elderly person, you call him uncle. Right? That's an uncle. You have your mother's brothers, their uncle. Your father's brothers, their uncle. Your parents' cousins and relatives are uncles, right? Your father-in-law, you probably call an uncle. There are so many different types of uncles. Which uncle are you referring to? Which one do you want to know about? And so this is from the fiqh of the scholars, that they don't just give blank answers like that. They ask and inquire so that they can ensure that they're giving the correct answer. And likewise, the Prophet ﷺ would understand the situation of the companions and he would address them accordingly. Hadith number 140, وَعَنْ أَبِي مَحْذُورَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْ أَنَّ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَالَ أَوَّلُ الْبَقْتِ رِضْوَانُ اللَّهِ وَأَوْسَطُهُ رَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَآخِرُهُ عَفْوُ اللَّهِ أخرجه الدارقطني بسند ضعيف جدا وللترمذي من حديث ابن عمر نحوه دون الأوسط وهو ضعيف أيضا. On the authority of Abu Mahdura رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْ, that the Prophet صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ said, the first of the time is the pleasure of Allah, the middle time is the mercy of Allah, and the ending time is the forgiveness of Allah, collected by Dharuqutni with a very weak chain of narration. And it is also in a Tirmidhi from the hadith of Ibn Umar with a similar wording, with the exception of the middle timing, and that is weak also. As we've mentioned previously in this book of Ibn Hajr rahimahullah ta'ala, one of the practices, one of the customs of Ibn Hajr rahimahullah in his book is that he doesn't just bring authentic hadith, he will bring weak hadith as well. And he knows they're weak and he does it intentionally because he mentions after the hadith that it's a weak hadith. Right? So no one's under any false illusions. It's not an issue of difference of opinion to him. It is clearly a weak hadith. And we said that the reason why he does this is because these ahadith are either very famous, so it's something which the people hear about and they're famous and people always mention it to one another. So he brings it to our attention that even though the hadith might be famous amongst people, it is weak. Or another reason may be that he brings the hadith to show that there is an act or of worship which is being based on this hadith which is weak. People are doing something which they shouldn't be doing and they have a hadith for it that they're basing it upon, but it is weak. And so Ibn Hajr rahimahullah ta'ala will sometimes bring these weak hadith to show that these are hadith which you need to be aware of. This is one such hadith in which it is said that the first timing, and we're talking about the timings of the prayer. So the earliest time is the pleasure of Allah. The middle time is the mercy of Allah. And the ending time of that prayer is the forgiveness or the pardon of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But as we said, this hadith is weak and Allah azza wa jal knows best. The next hadith, hadith number 141. وعن ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لا صلاة بعد الفجر إلا سجدتين أخرجه الخمسة إلا النسائي وفي رواية عبد الرزاق لا صلاة بعد طلوع الفجر إلا ركعتي الفجر ومثله للدارقطني عن ابن عمر ابن العاص. On the authority of Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, there is no prayer after Fajr except for two sajdas or two rak'ahs, collected by the five except al-Nasa'i. And in the narration of Abdul Razak, there is no prayer after Fajr except the two rak'ahs of Fajr. And this is also in al-Dharuqutni on the authority of Ibn Umar ibn al-As. These ahadith are also weak. So this hadith that is mentioned of Ibn Umar is weak as well. But basically what this hadith is saying is that even after Fajr, after you prayed Fajr, you're allowed to pray two rak'ahs. Whether those two rak'ahs are the two rak'ahs of Fajr that you might have missed before Fajr, or whether it's two other rak'ahs, just two rak'ahs generally. But as we said, this hadith is weak, and it also contradicts the other hadith that we mentioned last week, and that is that the Prophet ﷺ prohibited anyone from praying after Fajr until the sun has risen. After Fajr until the sun has risen, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. The next hadith, hadith number 142, وعن أم سلمة رضي الله عنها قالت صلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم العصر ثم دخل بيتي فصلى ركعتين فسألته فقال شغلت عن ركعتين بعد الظهر فصليتهما الآن فقلت أفنقضيهما إذا فاتتا قال لا أخرجه أحمد ولأبي داود عن عائشة رضي الله عنها بمعناه. On the authority of Umm Salama رضي الله عنها, who said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم prayed عصر, and then he entered into my house and he prayed two rak'ahs. So I asked him concerning them and he said that I became busy from my two rak'ahs after the dhuhr prayer, so I prayed them now. So I asked him, shall we also make them up if we miss them? He said no. And this is collected in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad. And in Sunan Abi Dawood, on the authority of Aisha radiallahu anha, there is also a similar hadith. This hadith is authentic. This hadith is authentic. And it is authenticated by a number of the scholars, like Sheikh bin Baz, rahimahullah ta'ala, and Ibn Rajab, and others as well. But this hadith is something which is specific to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And that is that if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would miss his sunan al-ratiba, and as we're going to come on to, the five prayers, or the four of them anyway, have sunnahs before or after them, or sometimes both. So as we said before, Fajr has two rak'ahs before, Dhuhr is four before and two after. There are no sunnah for Asr. For Maghrib it is two after, and for Isha it is two after, making a total of 12. And the Prophet ﷺ said, whoever prays 12 sunnahs a day, 12 of these sunnahs a day, then Allah Azza wa Jal will build for them a house in Jannah. So the point is that if the Prophet ﷺ happened to miss some of his sunnahs because he became busy, for example, he was in the masjid and after Dhuhr, instead of praying his sunnahs, a delegation came to him. Or some of the companions had an issue. Or some issue arose and so he was unable to pray. He would make them up later, even after the time had elapsed. So the general ruling is that these sunnahs are prayed within their time. So the sunnahs of Dhuhr are prayed at Dhuhr time. The sunnah of Maghrib is during Maghrib time. The sunnahs of Isha are prayed in Isha time. They're not made up after, nor can they be brought forward. So you can't pray Maghrib sunnahs after Dhuhr or after Fajr, right? Each one is with that prayer. However, if someone misses them for a valid reason, is it allowed to make them up or not? This is something which is being addressed in this hadith. And that is that it is allowed, it was allowed for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because this was to perfect his worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as we know, and as we discussed in the chapter of fasting, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had a number of issues of worship that were peculiar to him. They were special, specific to him, not for anyone else. So for example, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would fast in wisal, meaning that he wouldn't break his fast. He would fast on the Maghrib, he would continue to fast until the next day. But he prohibited the companions from doing so. So it's not allowed for anyone else to do so, but it was something specific to him sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he said, indeed my Lord, he gives me food and he gives me drink. Another issue which is also peculiar to him according to a number of the scholars of Islam is that the Hajjud, the night prayer, was obligatory for him. So for him it's obligatory, every night he would pray the Tahajjud prayer, and that's why you have the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in more or less all of the narrations, he would pray the night prayer every night. He would rarely miss the night prayer, if at all. And so again the scholars said that this was something special to him, that he had to pray the night prayer. As for everyone else, it is optional. It is a highly recommended sunnah, but if you don't do so, you're not sinful. Likewise here, the Prophet ﷺ would make up his sunnahs, even if the time elapsed. And this, all of this is to perfect the worship of the Prophet ﷺ to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As for us, then we are not allowed to do so, because Salama radiallahu anha explicitly asks the Prophet ﷺ, should we do this as well? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said no. So what do we do? From the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jalla, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us another way out. And that is that if we perform these sunnahs every day, and they're our normal practice, it's our normal habit and ritual to practice these sunnahs, to pray these sunnahs or any other sunnah, and then we miss them for a valid reason. So for example, for Fajr, you wake up late. And so you've missed the time to pray the sunnahs of Fajr, and you come to the masjid and you just pray Fajr, because you don't have enough time to do both. Or for example, you become extremely busy, or you become ill, or something like this, and you happen to miss a sunnah. The Prophet ﷺ told us that if someone performs an act of worship regularly, and then for a valid reason they miss it, then Allah Azza wa Jal will give them that same reward, because they missed it for a valid reason. And so that's a concession for us, that we don't have to make up those prayers, but Allah will give us the same reward. As for the Prophet ﷺ, then he would make up those prayers, and Allah Azza wa Jal knows best. Moving on from that is the next chapter, and that is Babul Adhan wal Iqama. Babul Adhani wal Iqama. The chapter of the Adhan and the Iqama. The Adhan in the Arabic language comes from a root word which basically means to proclaim or to call out. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this in the Quran in Surah At-Tawbah, وَأَذَانٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, a proclamation and a call from Allah and His Messenger. He uses the word adhan. And in the Sharia, it basically means a call which signifies the beginning of the time for prayer. A call which signifies the beginning of the time for prayer. That is the definition of adhan. Iqama basically literally means to stand. It means to stand. And what it means in the Sharia is a call which signifies that the prayer is about to commence or the people have stood for the prayer. And so the adhan is the one that is given as soon as the time enters. So as soon as the time enters, and we mentioned this last week as well, that the sunnah is as soon as the time enters, the adhan is given. The iqama is something which is given when the imam comes and he stands in front of the people. And that is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So during that time, they wouldn't have fixed times between the adhan and the iqama. So it wasn't this thing where you have 10 minutes between the two, or 15 minutes, or 5 minutes. That was left to the discretion of the imam. And that's the asl, that's how it should be. It's up to the imam. Sometimes the imam will come early, sometimes he'll be delayed. And there are narrations of how the companions waited for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to come and lead some of the prayers, and they would be waiting for some time. It would take them some time, and then he would come out late. And we mentioned this last week as well, concerning the Isha prayer, that if the Prophet ﷺ saw the companions had gathered, he would come early. If he saw that they were delayed and they were slow in coming to the masjid, he would delay the Isha prayer. The point is that it is at the discretion of the imam. And there's also a famous narration of Umar radiallahu an for the Jum'ah prayer, that he came at extremely late one Jum'ah prayer. And when the companions asked him, he said, because I only have one pair of clothes and I wanted to wash it on this day of Friday so that I have clean clothes, and I had to wait for those clothes to dry, so I was delayed in coming out. The point is that it is at the discretion of the imam. And the general rule of thumb is that the imam is the one who has the right to lead the prayer. So if the people come and they find that 5, 10 minutes, 15 minutes have gone from the adhan, the imam hasn't come out, they wait. And they're patient, unless someone knows that the imam isn't coming, he's delayed, he's not around, and he has appointed someone else to lead the prayer. The asl is that you just wait until the imam comes out. And this is basically the same kind of system that they're still using in many of the Muslim countries. So for example, if you go to many places in Saudi Arabia and so on, like the two harams, it is up to the discretion of the imam. So in Mecca and Medina, it's up to the imam when the iqama is given. So for example, sometimes it's 5 minutes, sometimes 10 minutes. In Hajj, for example, when you go, there's literally like 30 seconds between the two because of how busy Mecca is. They just lead the prayer straight away. But the point is that it is at the discretion of the imam, and Allah knows best. The adhan and the iqama are mentioned in the Quran, they're mentioned in the sunnah, and they're mentioned in the consensus of the scholars of Islam. In the Quran, it is in Surah Ma'idah, verse number 85, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا نَادَيْتُمْ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ, and when you call to the prayer. And this call that is being referred to is the adhan, that is Surah Ma'idah, verse number 85. And it is mentioned in the sunnah in many, many ahadith, some of them which we will come on to later. But one of them is the hadith of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu in Sahih Muslim, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that the muadhineen, the people who give the adhan, will have the tallest and the longest necks on Yawm al-Qiyamah. So because they were the ones who would call the people to prayer and the people would respond to them, then on Yawm al-Qiyamah Allah will give them the longest necks. And as we know from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, on that day Allah will bring the sun close to the heads of creation, and the people will sweat profusely as a result of this. And some of them, their sweat will reach their ankles, some their knees, some their waist, some will be nearly drowning in their own sweat. So on that day, when people are trying to escape their own sweat, the muadhineen will have the tallest and longest necks. Allah Azza wa Jal will give them long necks well above the people, and Allah Azza wa Jal knows best. And it is also mentioned in the books of fiqh as being something which the scholars have consensus over. What is the ruling of the adhan? The adhan, according to a number of the scholars of Islam, is fard kifaya. It is a communal obligation. So wherever there is a group of Muslims in a city, in a village, wherever there is a group of Muslims, the adhan must be given for the five prayers. Even if it is only in one place, the adhan must be given. And so it is a communal obligation. If someone fulfills it, then all of the other Muslims are free of blame. But if no one does it within the community, then all of the Muslims are sinful. That is what fard kifaya or communal obligation means. So if you have enough people to establish a congregation, then someone within that place must give the adhan. Someone within that city, within that village, even if it is only in one place, they must give the adhan. And so the adhan is something which is a fard kifaya or a communal obligation. The adhan and the iqama are mentioned in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we'll come on to that in a short while. And it is done for congregation, not for a singular prayer, but a congregation. So the adhan doesn't have to be given if a person is praying on their own, but it is to invite other people to come and to pray. If the prayers are combined, the scholars have said that one adhan is sufficient, and then two iqamas for the two prayers that are combined. So you give one adhan, and then two iqamas, one for each one. And then inshallah, this is something which we're also going to come onto in a short while as well, with more in more detail. The adhan is also only specific to the five prayers. It is specific only to the five prayers, Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, and Isha. There is no adhan for janazah, no adhan for Eid, no adhan for the eclipse prayer, no adhan for the rain prayer. There is no adhan for any other prayer except for these five prayers. The first hadith in this chapter, hadith number 143, an Abdullah ibn Zayd ibn Abdi Rabbih radiyallahu anhu qal, طاف بي وأنا نائم رجل فقال تقول الله أكبر الله أكبر فذكر الأذان بتربيع التكبير بغير ترجيع والإقامة فرادى إلا قد قامت الصلاة قال فلما أصبحت أتيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال إن هذا رؤيا حق الحديث أخرجه أحمد وأبو داود وصححه الترمذي وابن خزيمة وزاد أحمد في آخر قصة قول بلال رضي الله عنه في أذان الفجر الصلاة خير من النوم ولأبي خزيمة عن أنس رضي الله عنه قال من السنة إذا قال المؤذن في الفجر حي على الفلاح قال الصلاة خير من النوم. And the authority of Abdullah ibn Zayd radiyallahu anhu said that a person came to me during my sleep in a dream and he said, say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. And then he mentioned the adhan with the takbir four times without making tarji' and that the iqama was done once except for the statement of qad qamat as-salah. He said, so when I woke up, I came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and informed him. And he said, indeed, it is a truthful dream. And then the rest of the hadith, which is collected by Abu Ahmad, Abu Dawood, and authenticated by Tirmidhi ibn Khuzayma. In the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, at the end of the story, is the statement of Bilal radiallahu anhu, that in the adhan of Fajr, you also add, As-salatu khayrun min al-nawm. And in the narration of Ibn Khuzayma, and the authority of Anas radiallahu anhu, that he said, it is from the sunnah for the muaddin to say in Fajr, after hayya ala al-falah, As-salatu khayrun min al-nawm. This hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the hadith of Abdullah ibn Zayd, is considered to be the asl or the basis of this whole chapter, the chapter of adhan and iqama. It is probably the most important hadith within this chapter, the hadith of Abdullah ibn Zayd. And as we mentioned also in the previous chapters and books that we've studied of Bulugh al-Maram, that Ibn Hajr rahimahullah ta'ala normally has this method, that he mentions the most important hadith at the beginning of the chapter and then the other hadith. So the most important hadith are normally at the beginning of the chapters. This hadith is a long hadith, much longer than what is mentioned here by Ibn Hajr rahimahullah ta'ala. And the story is that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam came to Medina and they wanted to establish the congregational prayer. And you have to remember that before this in Mecca, the Muslims were persecuted. They couldn't perform Salatul Jama'ah openly, because the Meccans would persecute them. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would pray, and the companions would pray individually or in very small groups. And even if they wanted to come to the Haram, to Mecca by the Kaaba, they would pray individually. They never had a Jama'ah, and they never had their own masjid. But now that they came to Medina, they had a masjid. And they built Masjid Quba, and they built Masjid al-Nabawi, and the Muslims could not offer congregational prayer. The question that arose was how to call the people to prayer, how to invite them to the prayer. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as was his practice, he consulted his companions, asked them for their advice. And so people came with different ideas. Some of them said we should have a bell, like the Christians have a bell. Others said other things. Everyone had their own opinion. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wasn't content with any of these opinions, wasn't content with any idea. So the companions dispersed. During that night, Abdullah ibn Zayd radiallahu anhu, one of the companions, he saw in a dream that a man came to him. And he mentioned to this man that they wanted a call for prayer and that he was thinking of having a bowel or something similar to this. So the man in the dream said to him, don't do so. Rather have this call. And then he mentioned the adhan to him. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. And he went through the whole adhan. And then he went through the iqama and the way to do the iqama as well. So in the morning, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was informed by Abdullah ibn Zayd radiyallahu an of his dream. He said, this is what I saw in my dream. This is what the man said. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, as is mentioned in this narration by Ibn Hajar, that was a truthful dream. It was a truthful dream. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam took it and he established it as the adhan and the iqama. The adhan of Abdullah ibn Zayd, and we're going to come to some of the differences in the narrations of the companions as to exactly how the adhan is given in terms of the wording of the adhan. In this hadith, Ibn Hajar rahimahullah mentions that the adhan has four takbirs at the beginning, as we normally do, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. And then he says, bidun tarji', bighayri tarji'. Tarji' in the Arabic language is basically where in the adhan, and we're going to come on to this as well, in the adhan, you say the two shahadas, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, and ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, you say them four times each instead of two. That is tarji'. Twice you say them in a silent voice, and then twice in a loud voice. Okay, and we're going to come on to this in a bit more detail shortly as well. So inshallah we'll go into it in more detail then, and I'll explain exactly what it means. Also in the same narrations, we have the addition of as-salatu khayru min al-nawm in the Fajr prayer. And that is done in the Fajr prayer after saying hayya 'ala as-salah wa hayya 'ala al-falah. The muadzin says as-salatu khayru min al-nawm, which means that prayer is better than sleep. This adhan of Abdullah ibn Zayd radiyallahu an, once he saw this adhan, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to him, go and give it to Bilal. Go and inform Bilal, because Bilal has a much better voice. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam ordered Abdullah ibn Zayd to mention it to Bilal, and Bilal became the muadhin. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, because he has a better voice. So the scholars said that he had a louder voice and he had a nicer tone, a nicer voice. And that shows that these two things are something which the muadhin should possess. A loud voice, so the people can hear. And obviously this was before the time of microphones and speakers. And the second thing is a good voice, a nice voice, so that the people will respond to that adhan. This adhan of Abdullah ibn Zayd has 15 statements. 15 statements. So Allahu Akbar is four times. Then ashhadu an la ilaha illallah twice, ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah twice, hayya 'ala as-salah twice, hayya 'ala al-falah twice, Allahu Akbar again twice, and then la ilaha illallah once. Altogether, that makes 15 statements. So this is the hadith of Abdullah ibn Zayd radiyallahu anhu, and as I said, it is the asl, it is the, if you like, the most important hadith within this chapter. One of the issues that the scholars also mention concerning this adhan is that one of the other conditions of the muadhin. So he has to have a good voice, has to be someone who knows the times of the prayer, has to have a loud voice. Also something which is important is that the person can recite the adhan correctly, that they don't make mistakes in the adhan to the extent that they change the meaning of the adhan. So for example, one of the examples that the scholars give is in the shahadatain, when you say ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, a common mistake is where people put a mad under alif. So instead of saying ashhadu, they say ashhadu. Right? And this is common and you hear it in certain adhans. This changes the meaning. Because alif with a mad at the beginning of any sentence becomes a question. Becomes a hamzatul istifham. And Allah mentions this in the Quran as well. Allahu khayrun amma yushrikun. Is Allah better or the gods that they ascribe? And there is a rhetorical question that Allah asks, but He mentions it with this alif and mad. So if someone says instead of ashhadu, they say ashhadu, they're not no longer saying that I testify that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah. They're not asking a question. Is it true that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah? So they change the meaning completely. And so the adhan now, you know, that shahadatain takes on a completely different slant. And so that's something which it is also important for the muadhin to have, and that is the knowledge of the Arabic language. Inshallah, we'll go over one more hadith, the final hadith. حديث نمبر 144 وعن أبي محذورة رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم علمه الأذان فذكر فيه الترجيع أخرجه مسلم ولكن ذكر التكبير في أوله مرتين فقط ورواه الخمسة فذكروه مربعا. And the authority of Abu Mahdura radiallahu anhu that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam taught him the adhan and he mentioned within it the tarji' and this is collected by Muslim and he also mentioned in this narration that the takbir at the beginning is only twice instead of four times and it is also collected by the five but they mentioned that the takbir is four times. This hadith is authentic. It's in Sahih Muslim as we mentioned. Abu Mahdura, the companion who narrates this hadith radiallahu anhu, was the muazzin of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Mecca. So we said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a number of muazzins. In Mecca it was Abu Mahdura. In Medina it was Bilal and Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktum radiallahu anhum. So this hadith is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught him the adhan and he mentioned within it the tarji'. There are three different narrations of the adhan in terms of the wording of the adhan. The first narration is the narration that we mentioned in the previous hadith of Abdullah ibn Sayyid. And that is the adhan that we normally give in all of the masjids. So any masjid that you go, you'll most likely hear that same adhan. The adhan that you hear here, adhan you hear in Mecca, in Medina, that same adhan that you hear more or less everywhere. That is of 15 statements. That is the hadith of Abdullah ibn Sayyid. It is also known as the adhan of Bilal radiallahu anhu. That's number one. That's the first narration that you find in the sunnah. The second narration that you find in the sunnah is taken from this hadith of Abu Mahdura. And that is that the adhan has 17 statements. 17, not 15, 17. And the way that those 17 are is that the takbir at the beginning is only twice. So instead of saying Allahu Akbar, then Allahu Akbar again, you only say it twice. You only say Allahu Akbar at the beginning. So not four times, twice. And then what you add is tarji'. What tarji' is, as I mentioned before, is that the shahadatain is doubled. So instead of mentioning each one twice, you mention each one four times. And the way that you do it is that you do it twice silently and then twice aloud. So normally what we do is we say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, and then Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, then Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. What you would do instead, according to this narration in Sahih Muslim, is that the muadhin says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah silently to himself. So he'll do, like no one will hear it except him. And then he'll do that twice, and then he'll say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah loudly. And then for the other one, Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, again, he'll say it silently twice, no one will hear him. And then he'll say it twice aloud. That is tarji'. That is tarji'. And that is the second narration that you find within the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as is in this hadith of Imam Muslim. The third narration is also with tarji'. So for the two shahadas, again, two are done silently, then two loud. Then the other shahada, two silently and two loud. But the addition is that the takbir is done four times at the beginning instead of twice. So that hadith becomes 19 statements. So we have three narrations of the adhan. Number one is 15 statements, the normal adhan that we have. Number two is 17 statements with the takbir twice only at the beginning and then tarji' on the two shahadas. And number three is 19 statements with four takbirs at the beginning plus the tarji' on the two shahadas. That is the three narrations. All of them are authentic. All of them are authentic and established within the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Although some of the scholars have differed over one or two of the slight issues, but it seems that all of them are authentic. So what do you do? Now you have these three narrations of takbir, of the adhan. The general ruling is in the principles of fiqh that when you come to different narrations of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in any issue, then what you do is, number one is you look for if the one is authentic and one is not. So it's very simple. If one is authentic, one is weak, it's very easy. What is authentic, you take. What is weak, you leave. Right? That makes it very simple. Number two is you can't do that because all of it's authentic. Like in this case, everything is authentic. So what you do then is you try to combine. You do your best to combine and apply all of those hadith. And number three is if you can't do that, then something has to be abrogated. One thing is old and one thing is new. One thing abrogates the other. In this narration and in generally in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where you have narrations like this, where there's not a direct statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that one is right, one is wrong, or one is obligatory, one is prohibited, but you just have different ways of doing the same thing, then you apply them all. And basically what that means is that you do all of them at some point or another. So generally the scholars are of the opinion that the hadith, the adhan of Bilal is the strongest in terms of its chain of narration, and it seemed to be the most common. So that would be the most regular adhan that you do. But then you would also do the other ones here and there as well to revive that sunnah and to show the people that it is allowed. And this was the opinion of Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah and many of the scholars of hadith, and it is a well-known principle of fiqh that you combine and apply all of them. And this is not only in this issue, but we're going to come on to many examples of this, especially in the chapter of prayer. Another example that I'll just give you, just so that inshallah you understand, is that the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ in the witr prayer. The witr prayer can either be one rak'ah, can be three rak'ahs, can be five, can be seven, can be nine, can be 11. All of this is authentically reported, and inshallah we'll come on to that in the relevant chapter. But the point is that it is the sunnah therefore to apply it all as well. So not just to always do one, or always three, or always five, but that you change and swap and change as much as you can. So you do one sometimes, you do three sometimes, you do five sometimes. Even with the three, there are two ways of doing the three. Right? As you know, for those of you that come here and you pray witr in Ramadan, sometimes what the imam does is he prays three altogether. Doesn't sit in the middle, prays three altogether. Sometimes he prays two, gives a salam, stands and does one. Both of them are authentically reported. So the point is that you don't say that this is right, this is wrong, this is the sunnah, this is not the sunnah, or that you say to someone that's doing one of them that you're wrong, but rather you apply all of them. You use all of them so that you apply the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is different to an issue which we took last week, which was about praying in the prohibited times. That's a completely different issue, because here you have two completely contradictory hadith. One says pray, one says don't pray. You can't combine between the two. Can't combine between two opposites. However, in this issue, you don't have an issue of prohibition and obligation. What you have is just different ways of doing the same thing. Sometimes it's 15, sometimes 17 statements, sometimes 19. And so the rule is that you apply all of them as much as you can, and that seems to be the strongest opinion, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. So if you go to a masjid and you find that someone's doing 19 statements or 17, don't freak out, don't go crazy. It is all the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, inshaAllah. So inshaAllah with that we'll conclude. If there's any questions, we'll take them, otherwise we'll stop.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم